Topological assumption on the graph. Topological means that the method does not cancel. And the assumption was formulated in this way. The graph is made in such a way that every point in the graph lies on a line, which is somewhat in the structure, hidden in the structure of the graph. For example, for this edge, a possible line is this one. A line is a sequence of edges that connects a different point at infinity. Okay? This is what is called a train in the graph theoretical language. This is a topological hypothesis that guarantees the fact that the infinity is not attained, even though it has a well-known value, which is the value of the energy correspondence of the soliton. Of course, this one is only one possible formulation of the H hypothesis. But yesterday, from the example, probably it was already quite clear that when this hypothesis is not fulfilled, it means that the graph has something like a bottleneck. So an edge, then there is here a compact part. All the points of this cat-edge, what is a cat-edge? Cat-edge is an edge such that if you remove it, then the graph is separating into different connected components. So all the points in this cat-edge do not belong to any train that connects to different points. And so every time H is violated, there are two possibilities. Either there is only one half line. Okay, one half line, you cannot have two different points at infinity. Or there is a situation like that. And this situation can be written in this way. There is an edge such that if you remove it, then your graph is divided in two connected components, and one of these components, of the resulting components, is compact. This is the another way of formulating this hypothesis. So this hypothesis prevents ground state from existing, unless you are on a line or on a bubble tower, and so on. So this was the main result of yesterday. Today I would like to go to another problem, the problem of the critical case. So up to now, the power p in the nonlinear term was less than 6. And the prototype was p equal to 4. When I performed explicit computation, I always took p equal to 4. Because p equal to 4 is the so-called cubic case, which is integrable. Integrable means integrable on the line. On the graph, it is a much more complicated issue, but integrability on the line means a lot of things. Probably the physical interest, most relevant things, is that you have an infinity of conservation laws, so independent conservation laws. But here, for our concerns, integrability just meant that we can perform explicit computation. So we have this beautiful expression for the energy of the solid minus μ/2. Now we pass to the sixth power. Sixth power is not integrable this time. We can perform still some explicit computation, but this is not the point. This is not integrable. Physical interpretation of the sixth power. So, if you remember what I sketched in the first lecture, there was a slide on the passage from linearity to non-linearity. Okay? The idea was that if you have on the line a system of interacting bosons, identical interacting bosons, and the interaction is short range. In our language, this meant V. This is short range. This is shrinking when n goes to infinity. And weak coupling, this means there is an n. And gamma was taken to be between 0 and 1. If you have this interaction, in the limit for n that goes to infinity, you find a non-linear equation for the one-body problem. The premise was that the initial data was factorized. Do you remember? The initial data was a wave function, a wave function phi for the first particle, the same wave function phi for the second particle up to wave function phi for the nth particle. So in the limit, this interaction, which is a pair interaction, gave this contribution a potential which is nothing but the same, so this psi naught, so which is nothing but the evolution of psi naught according to a nonlinear equation, the modulus square times the same phi. So this is quite a complicated limit, has a long history, but the idea is that this is, if this is the scale, then in the limit you find for the single particle a nonlinear evolution which is cubic. Okay? Here the bow is cubic, and when going into the energy, the cubic of the equation becomes a fourth part, becomes the integral bits. But here, in the critical power nonlinearity, we have a power six. So, can it be deduced from a Schrödinger equation like that? And in this case, how should we define the potential? The answer is quite simple. So, if you follow the proof of this limit, you find that the important thing is that here all interactions are in pairs. This is quite normal in physics. But if you put into the equation an interaction of the kind of three body, V that depends, that concerns three particles, then what you find at the end is not the cubic, but it is the quintic. This has been made by Thomas Chen. If I remember well, it was Thomas Chen from Princeton. It was in 2010. So the quintic power in the equation means the sixth power. So if we want to force a physical interpretation of this energy, it's just a sort of joke at this level. If you want to force this, you can say that this is the energy of the condensate where particles do not interact in pairs, but they only interact in triplets. Does it exist, such a gas? As far as I know, it does not exist. But nowadays, the technology of Bose-Einstein condensator is very, very, very fine. So you can go to people working in this laboratory, so low energy physics, working on Bose-Einstein condensator, building up Bose-Einstein condensator, practically order what you want. You want the Bose-Einstein condensator, which is a cigar shape, which is ramified, which is disc shaped, and so on. And they are able to build it. They're able to model the trap using optical and magnetic devices. So there is another thing that they can do. They can use a mechanism called Feshbach resonance, which is quite a complicated mechanism that concerns the interaction of couples of bosons. And by magnetic field, they can tune, using this Feshbach resonance, they can tune the interaction between the couple of particles. So I feel allowed to dream that in the future they will be able to tune such interaction in order to make it disappear and to leave only the three-body interaction that gives this energy function. So this is just a way of forcing a possible future physical interpretation of this function. Okay. So now, let me go back to mathematics. So this is the energy, and we want to minimize it on this space. I remember you that this space is the natural space. H1 means that you have enough regularity to write down these integrals, and that the functions you are considering are continuous at vertices of the graph. The new here means that you have a mass constraint. The L2 norm, the squared L2 norm of functions you are considering is equal to mu. Now, this problem is different. It's much more delicate than the subcritical that we studied until yesterday. And so let me just explain you why this power is so special. Why this power, what does critical mean in this context? Okay? So again, go back to the subcritical or the generic P. Okay? Remember what I said at the very beginning of this lecture. I said, okay, when you look at this functional, here there is a quadratic or positive term. Here there is a negative term with a power p. So if you just put a factor here, let me call it square root of lambda. You can call it lambda, but for me it is more comfortable to call it square root of lambda, positive factor here, and push this factor up to infinity, this grows quadratically, so it grows like lambda. This grows like lambda to the fifth power. Since p was chosen to be greater than 2, then this grows more. The negative term grows more than the positive term. So in the limit, the energy, goes to minus infinity. Okay? So the idea is that if you take a function and just make it larger and larger by a scaling factor, the energy becomes more and more negative up to minus infinity. Okay? So this was the reason why, in order to give a sense to the minimization problem, we have to add a constraint. Of course, you cannot do such a thing by conserving the mass constraint. In order to conserve the mass constraint, to preserve the mass, you have to write something like that. Sorry, here there is an equal missing. I write it better. So you start by a function u. What you do is simply squeezing the function, and by squeezing I also mean that you are making it taller and taller. Start from a function. I always picture here a sort of soliton, but you can choose whatever function you prefer. So start from this guy, this is u, and then you define a u lambda is equal to square root of lambda u of lambda x. This means, when lambda is greater than 1, this means that the domain is smaller, but the function is taller. Okay? So larger values of the function here means that this guy becomes larger as an absolute value, so more and more negative. So it seems that you are winning again, but if you make it larger and larger, preserving the antinorm, the slope here increases. If the slope increases, the first term increases. So there is a competition when doing this transformation, which is mass-preserving, so it is allowed in our problem. When doing this transformation, there is a competition between the kinetic term, the positive term, and the nonlinear term, which is negative. Okay? So the question is, who wins between these two? And in order to understand who wins, just compute what is the energy of this squeezed state u lambda. And it is very simple to do, because if this is u lambda, then u lambda dot is equal to lambda to the 3 halves u of lambda x. Then compute the kinetic energy, you have to compute u lambda dot to the square, and this is lambda to the third power, then u dot square lambda x, be integrated in the variable x, but here you have lambda, so you just multiply by lambda here and divide by lambda here. So what you find is lambda squared. This is the kinetic energy associated to u, because you are integrating the same variable in which the function is evaluated. So this is u dot squared. Okay? This is the first term, the kinetic energy. So go to the other term and compute the nonlinearity. The nonlinearity is simply lambda to the p over 2, because there is a square root, integral of u p to the pth power lambda x, as before, this is dx lambda, so you have to divide by lambda, and this scales as lambda p over 2 integral of up. So the kinetic term takes a factor lambda squared, so the positive term scales like lambda squared, the negative term scales like lambda to the p half minus 1. This is the same energy, we write it here. So in order to understand who wins the competition for lambda going to infinity, it is sufficient to evaluate which is the largest power here, 2 or p over 2 minus 1. So this is an elementary computation, but the point is that when p is equal to 6, this is equal to 2, 3 minus 1 equal to 2. So for p equal to 6, the two powers are the same. For p greater than 6, the nonlinear term is stronger, so the energy goes to minus infinity. For p less than 6, the kinetic term is stronger, so the energy goes to plus infinity. And for p equal to 6, there is an equilibrium, sort of fair competition between the kinetic and the nonlinear term. And the energy scales in this way. When applying this Maxwell-Serling transformation, the energy scales in this way. So this is why p equal to 6 is the critical power nonlinearity, because when we perform this transformation, the balance between kinetic and nonlinear energy changes in correspondence of p equal to 6. Okay? So in the subcritical case, this is favorable to the positive term, the kinetic term. For p greater than 6, this is favorable to, this is good for the nonlinear term. But one here should think that this is just an effect of the particular transformation we have considered. So this is not a general result. But indeed it is a general result. And the more sophisticated instrument tool we have to introduce is an estimate. Indeed it is a huge family of estimates called Galliardo-Nirenberg estimate, which are very famous for people working in functional analysis. And you see, it is an estimate of the nonlinear term, okay? Again, we are on the line. This estimate is very well known on the line. And this is the nonlinear term. This p here means Lp of r. So the integral appearing in the nonlinear term, which is exactly this one, can be estimated by the L2 norm of the OU prime. So to the kinetic energy, this is the kinetic energy to some power, times, okay, here there is another factor, but this factor is nothing but the mass to some power. So take this estimate and put it into the energy. Okay? In the energy, you have the kinetic term. This is not touched by this estimate. And then you have the nonlinear term with a minus sign. When you estimate this integral in the nonlinear term from above, then because of the minus sign, this becomes an estimate from below. So you have that the energy is estimated from below by the kinetic energy minus this quantity here. This quantity has a constant part, which is C over P times the mass. The mass is fixed, so can be absorbed into the constant. And again, the kinetic energy to some power. And now, the competition between the kinetic and the nonlinear term in the energy becomes the competition between kinetic energy and the kinetic energy to some power. So the idea is to look whether the power of the kinetic energy in the positive term is greater, equal, or lower than the power of the kinetic energy in the nonlinear. This is exactly like before, but it is much more general, because this estimate holds for every function in H1. Okay? And again, the competition is the same. It's the power 2 against p over 2 minus 1. So for p equal to 6, you have 3 minus 1, which is equal to 2. And again, this is critical. Okay, this is power 6 is critical. So let me better explain this point, because it is a key point. So by this Gagliardo-Nirenberg estimate, which is a nowadays classical, I think the family of Gagliardo-Nirenberg estimate, which is very large, was found in the 70s, I think. And what happens is that the energy is greater than, okay, you have one half, let me call x minus a constant, and in this constant here I can see p and also the mass. This is x squared, and this is x to p over 2 minus 1, okay? Where x is u prime L2, okay? This is a function of x. It's just a function of x. As a function of x, is p is less than 6, then this power is less than 2, and we can draw a graph where very easily for 0, the value is 0, and when x grows, this term, the lowest power is prevailing, and then the largest power becomes prevailing, so it is like that. This means that for p less than 6, the energy is lower bound. Okay. For p greater than 6, on the other hand, the graph is completely reversed, because this power is greater than 2. So this time the energy is like that. So the energy here is not lower bound. Okay. This is what is written here in the center of this line. For p equal to 6, it is more complicated. Because it depends, because here we have 2, so for p equal to 6, we have 1 half minus c x to the second power, and this is lower bounded or lower unbounded depending on the value of c. And the value of c is determined by the mass. So for p equal to 6, mass becomes an important parameter. Up to now, it was not so important. We had a lot of results for every mass that exists, the ground state for every mass that does not exist, any ground state. But now mass becomes an important parameter. This is another specific factor of the critical power. And let me give you the result, which are quite famous results, and I will explain them on the real line. So when g is equal to the real line, again, classical well-known problem. Let us define this value, this mu r. This is called the critical mass. Why is it called the critical mass? Because in correspondence to this value, there is a sudden change in the behavior of the energy. Oh, this is a, here there is a notation I did not define, sorry, but simply E r of mu is the incidence, regardless of the fact that it is attained or not, of the energy on r for u in H1 mu of r. So the symptom, so what I'm asking here is whether the energy function along the line is lower bounded or not. And The answer is that in the critical case, if the mass is large enough, then it is not lower bounded. The intimum is minus infinity. And below the critical mass, on when mu is exactly the critical mass, the energy is lower bounded and the intimum is exactly zero. So this is a notion of threshold mass. Okay? Below and after the threshold mass, the behavior of the functional is very different. It is clear that here there is no ground state. But what happened in the subcritical mass case? So, again, the answer is quite surprising because the answer is that ground states exist only if the mass is exactly the critical one. This is strange, again. So, for the line, we had the whole family of solitons in the subcritical case stating that for every mass that was a soliton, modulo translations, modulo sign, modulo phase. But for every mass that was a soliton. Now you still have a soliton. This is the soliton in the critical case. So the shape is more or less the same. You have the hyperbolic septon and you have some coefficient here. But all the other solitons are obtained by this, by phase, translations, and by this transformation. This transformation preserves the mass. This is a big change with respect to the subcritical case. Also, in subcritical case, you had a transformation like that. We were able to exploit it for people to fall. When I brought down the derivation of the exact form of the soliton in the case P equal to form, then I said, you can define some phi lambda is equal lambda phi one lambda x. This was the soliton we have found. These are all other solitons, modulo translations and modulo phases. But now, here, moving this lambda, we will also change the mass. So we will give the existence of solitons for every mass. Here now, moving this lambda, now the scaling has changed. Moving this lambda does not attain the mass. The autonomy is preserved. Sorry, I did not perform the computation, but it is quite easy. So it is like this sort of, I don't want to do that because I'm confusing the two lambdas. Okay, but in any case, all these guys have the same mass, which is exactly the critical mass. So there are also other dynamical consequences of the critical case. I don't want to insist too much on that. So the critical case is very different from the line, from all the other cases. And in some sense, it is quite trivial. Okay? You only have solution for a particular case of the mass, and then otherwise you have not lower boundedness or the fact that the interval is not okay. This is quite trivial. But let us understand why this critical mass arises. And again, we have to use Galliardo-Nirenberg inequalities. For P, and we specialize Galliardo-Nirenberg inequality for P equal to 6. And this is the Galliardo-Nirenberg inequality for the nonlinear term in the power critical case. And we say that it is estimated by the kinetic energy, exactly the kinetic energy with the power 2, which is important, times a constant and the mass to the square power. The mass is the square of the antinomy. Here is the fourth power of the antinomy. Now it is important to use this Galliardo-Nirenberg inequality in an optimal way. From now on it is quite important. It means that here Kr is the best constant that we can do in the Galliardo-Nirenberg inequality. What I mean by best constant? Because so when we read an estimate like that, we say, oh, this is a beautiful estimate, I put it into my energy and I obtain some information, very happy. Okay. But the message of the estimate can be read in a more effective way, just saying that this quantity, L6 norm to the power 6, divided by the L2 norm to the power 4 and the L2 norm of the prime derivative, the power 2, by changing u inside our space H1, is always bounded it is not unbounded. This is the message of the Galilean case. Okay. Now, instead of a generic C, here we use the optimal C. What does it mean? That here we use Kr, which is the infimum of all possible C's we can use, and it is the supremum of the values of this equation. Okay. Is it clear how this estimate can be read? This supremum, it says that this supremum is finite. This is the message of the estimate. But from now on, it is important that we use exactly this Kr, not a generic constant, but the optimal constant. It exists, and it is finite. Now we put this guy here into the energy. So let me rewrite the energy. So this is a kinetic energy, u prime 2 squared over 2, and I write 2 like 3 over 6. Here there is a 1/6, and I gather this 1/6 factor outside the parentheses. So here it is just a way of rewriting the energy, but here I use the Galliardo-Nirenberg estimate. So here there is a kinetic energy which is gathered outside here. And inside this parenthesis, I have this 3 minus kr mu to the square. Okay? It is clear. Here I just used the Galliardo-Nirenberg estimate. So what I got is that the energy is estimated from below by 1/6 is not important, but by two factors. A factor which is the kinetic energy, and it is always non-negative, and another factor here that, depending on the mass, can be either positive or negative. Yes. So, if the mass here is small, mass is smaller than this quantity, 3 over the optimal constant in the Galliardo-Nirenberg estimate. So, then this factor is strictly positive, the kinetic energy is strictly positive in H1 space, so the energy is strictly positive. Again, if the mass is smaller than some value here, then the energy is strictly positive. Okay. Now, of course, it cannot reach zero. The energy can never be zero for any u. But if we consider, as usual, a non-compact graph, if we consider on the line a state, we use the mass preserving transformation as before, but now, so we use u lambda equal to square root of lambda u of lambda x, and we let lambda go not to infinity but to zero. What happens? So this is going to zero, so the function is becoming lower and lower, and because of this lambda here going to zero, the function is fatted. So take this function, apply mass preserving transformation, you obtain a function which is very spread on the line, and it happens that the infimum in lambda doing this transformation goes to zero. So zero cannot be attained, but asymptotically can be attained. This means that zero is the infimum, but it is not attained, so there is no ground state. So in this way, we explain this fact here. So remember the hypothesis. The hypothesis was that the mass was less than a value here, 3 over the optimal constant in the Galliardo-Nirenberg inequality. And now we consider the other hypothesis. The mass to the square power is greater than the same constant. And moreover, we consider a function which is close to optimality. What does it mean, close to optimality? It means that it may be that this guy here, this ratio, is not Kr. Because Kr is the supremum of this ratio, so it could also not be attained. But it is very close. Since Kr is the supremum, in this ratio there are functions that give a ratio which is very close to Kr. For example, fixed a very small epsilon, and you always find a U such that this ratio is equal to 3R minus epsilon. Very, very small. So this is the meaning of U close to optimality. And then, do it like before. So, you can use a U such that this ratio. Okay, you can find it also equal, but you can find it also greater or equal KR minus X. Also greater. Okay, this is by the definition of supreme. Okay, this is the supreme, it cannot be attained, but KR minus epsilon is attained and also overcome by some U. So use that U, and what you find is that this energy is less or equal than the same quantity as before, except that here we don't have Kr, but Kr minus epsilon. So we are using this inequality for a special U close to optimality. But since mu is greater than 3 over Kr, now this factor here is negative. So we have that the energy of a U close to optimality in the Gallardo-Nirenberg inequality with a mass greater than this 3 over Kr is negative. So we found that the message is that if mu is greater than the square root of 3 over Kr, then there is some U whose energy is strictly negative. And again, we use the mass preserving transformation. This time, let lambda go to infinity. With this mass preserving transformation, the energy just goes like lambda squared, the energy of U. And so lambda squared for a negative number with lambda that goes to infinity gives minus infinity. So just reasoning on this inequality, we have that if the mass is larger than this 3 over Kr, then the infimum of the energy at a fixed mass is minus infinity. So here we have proven this fact here. So exceeding a special value of the mass, we have minus infinity. Below the special value of the mass, the infimum is zero. This is only encoded in the Gallardo-Nirenberg. Of course, this 3 over Kr is what we call at the beginning the critical value of the mass. Of course, I did not prove and I did not give any hint of the proof about of the Gallardo-Nirenberg estimate. If you don't know it, it's contained in the Brizzi book. Of course, one could repeat the same reasoning for the half line, and what one finds is that the critical mass of the half line is the critical mass of the line divided by 2. And since there is this relationship between critical mass and optimal constant in the Gallardo-Nirenberg estimate, that the optimal constant in the Gallardo-Nirenberg estimate of the half line is 4 times the constant for the line. Okay? So the critical mass of the half line is lower than the critical mass of the line, and the Kr plus is larger than Kr. And notice that in order to study the critical case on the line and also on the half line, it is exactly the same computation, we exploited two facts. First, the Gallardo-Nirenberg inequality, just one of them. Second, the possibility of squeezing, that gives us minus infinity when the mass is large, and of stretching, that gives us zero when the mass is large. Now we go to the graph. Now we go to the case of the graph. And try to generalize. So in particular, we try to see whether these two ingredients are available in the graph. So the first, Gallardo-Nirenberg inequality, is available on the graphs. And I'll show you in a very, very quick way. Gagliardo Nuremberg on a generic but non-compact graph. Okay. So what we want to estimate here is the nonlinear term in the energy. Let me consider the critical case, but we can also study any power. It's not a problem. This is on the graph. Rearrange monotonically U. A monotonous rearrangement of U, this U star, has the same LP norm for every phi. And it is in the half line. Okay? In the half line, there is a Gagliardo-Nuremberg inequality. So this is less or equal than KR plus then U star fourth power, and this is the LP norm on the half line, and then U star prime to the second power on the line. This is just Gagliardo-Nuremberg on the half line. Now we go back to, from the half line to the graph, and we have that KR plus is untouched. Here, going back to U, since U star is a rearrangement, the L2 norm is preserved. And now we use the fact that the kinetic energy of the rearranged function is less or equal than the kinetic energy of the original function. So what is this guy? This is a Gagliardo-Nuremberg inequality. The same Gagliardo-Nuremberg only on the half line with the same constant. Except that this time, this KR plus could not be the optimal constant on the graph. But this is very simple and uses the arrangement. And in order to see that it could not be the best constant on the graph, consider in blue the case that the number of counterimage of every t is greater or equal than 2 for every t in the range of u. You can perform exactly the same computation, but instead of having u star here, you can use u hat, which is the symmetric rearrangement. Which is the symmetric rearrangement of u on the line. So it is the same thing. The nonlinear term in the energy is preserved. So here you have KR, and here you have exactly the same. So it's quite boring to do all this stuff. So this is exactly the same, except here we have KR. KR is better than KR because it's less. So you easily get. By arrangement, you easily get a Gagliardo-Nuremberg theory for graph. Sorry, where am I?
What did happen? I probably pushed it. Oh, it was like 40.
So, the point is that also on a generic graph, there is a Gagliardo-Nuremberg inequality with its optimal constant Kg, and exactly as before, by analogy, we can define a critical mass of the graph in this way. Critical mass of the graph to the second power is equal to 3 over Kg. Now remember that from here you can, and from other arguments, you can easily say that for every g, the k is less than the k of r plus and greater than the k of kr. Okay, this is easy. Less than kr plus is clear from here. Okay, we obtain the Gagliardo-Nuremberg inequality with this constant, but the optimal constant is the infimum among all possible constants. So you have this first.
Sorry, this first. Second inequality.
But why do you have the first? You have the first simply because if you consider non-compact graphs, then you can asymptotically reproduce every function on the line by using the half line of the non-compact graph. You take the function on the line, you put it on the half line very far away, you just cut off the origin, as we saw yesterday. So the function that realizes the optimal value on the line can be arbitrarily well approximated on the half line of the graph. And so this constant can be, if not attained, can be however arbitrarily approximated, and we take in supremum, we have exactly kr. So kg attains kr, and it is possibly given. So kg is between kr and kr plus. This is another Pinchinus theorem. Half line and half line, in some sense, are the two extremas for all non-compact graphs. And since the inverse of kg is proportional to the square of μg, the critical mass of the graph is between the critical mass of the half line and the critical mass of the graph. But this is just a definition, just an analogy. There is a Gagliardo-Nirenberg inequality, and then the Gagliardo-Nirenberg inequality gives a notion of critical mass. Now the question is whether the meaning of the critical mass is the same as the meaning of UR. What do I mean? I mean that below mu g you have zero, and beyond mu g you have minus infinity as the infinite. And here the answer is this is strange size. So. Here the answer is a bit more complicated. But so we can repeat the same argument. So take Gagliardo-Nirenberg inequality and with optimal constant, put it in the expression of the energy, and you see that you are below, if you are below or equal to mu g, then the infimum is equal to zero. And moreover, you can see that you are beyond the mu g, then the energy is negative. But it is not easy to understand whether it is true or not that this infimum is minus infinity, like in the case of the line. Okay. But remember how did we see that in the case of the line, the minimum for large mass was minus infinity? We just took a function with a large mass and exploit mass preserving transformation, pushing lambda up to infinity. When lambda goes to infinity, it is concentrated and becomes taller, and the energy goes to minus infinity. So we squeeze the function. But the point is that in the line, squeezing it is always possible. On the graphs, it is not always possible. Here I give just an example of this impossibility. The example is given by the Tarpov graph. This is the Tarpov graph, and this is a sort of function on the graph. And here, I was not able to make it smooth, but it's not important at all. Just my inability to do smooth pictures. So consider for example this graph, and by using the arrangement one can see that the possible minimizers are made like that. So there is a soliton tail here, and here there is a which is symmetric. There is some perspective, but probably it is symmetric, and the maximum is here. Okay. Now, when you try to shrink this function, the problem is that you shrink also this ring, but the length of this ring, if you want, the length of the domain of this ring must always be the same L, because the graph, the Tarpov, is given with its L. It's a metric graph, L is given. If you try to shrink the function, the graph cannot remain the same. So shrinking is not always possible. Shrinking was the way to see that the energy went to minus infinity here. But in graphs, it is not always possible. And this is an intuitive way to see it. But there is a more technical way to see it. So consider a generic function here, not only this candidate minimizer here, but a generic function. And call capital M the maximum of the function, and small, and the minimum top of the whole function, because of course the function cannot have, to not have a minimum, just go to zero, but the minimum only on the ring. This is well defined. Okay? What happens is that if you consider the range of u, the interval in the range between the minimum on the ring and the maximum on the whole function, that can also be on the ring, it's not important, in this interval, all points always have two pre-images. This is the main fact for which it is not possible to have a good result by a shrinking. So, the idea is that when you go, or you start from a mass which is between the critical mass of the graph and the critical mass of the line, so below the two. So what happens is that when you try to shrink, at the end, the domain of the function is is smaller than the length of the ring. But one can prove that the counter image of this interval is at least equal to the length of the ring. So if you are inside a set, only inside a set that is smaller than the domain of the ring, but you are forced to have two counter images in an interval which is at least the domain of the ring, the conclusion is that you must have two counter images on the domain of the ring. It's a bit technical, but I try to give the idea. The idea is that try to shrink in a structure like that. What you find at the end of the ring will be a shrunk function on the line. But if your mass is below the critical mass of the line, you cannot go to infinity, to minus infinity. This is the idea, which is below the technical proof, but the naive idea that you cannot shrink here preserved in the graph is the same. So remember, there were two ingredients to go to minus infinity. The first ingredient was the Gagliardo-Nirenberg estimate. The second ingredient was the possibility of shrinking. Here you have, in graphs, you have Gagliardo-Nirenberg, you do not always have the possibility of shrinking. Okay. Now, in order to make this counterexample effective, you need graphs for which the critical mass is strictly below the mass of the critical mass on the line. And there are examples. Okay, and I conclude this lecture on this small course with four results who do not cover all the possibility, and they are not, we are writing them, but proofs are there, and so I think that the paper will be read in I hope in some weeks. But first, consider a non-compact graph having at least one terminal edge. Then, in this case, the critical mass of the graph is equal to the critical mass of the half line, and the behavior of the energy is somewhat trivial, somewhat the same as for the half line. You have a sudden jump from minus infinity and plus infinity passing through the critical mass of the graph. It is quite easy to say why. Remember that solitons can be shrunk, okay? But also half soliton can be shrunk. So you can imagine a sequence of functions that reproduce half solitons on this pendant and shrink them. If you are beyond the critical mass on the half line, in this way you go to minus infinity. Except in several locations before. So what is important here is just the pendant. The pendant is able to absorb all the best functions, functions with the lowest energy. Its lowest energy is minus infinity if mu is greater than the critical mass of R plus. Otherwise, it is zero by just spreading a state on a half line. So this is not very interesting. So it is somewhat equivalent to the half line. The point is that in the critical case, you don't have natural length scale. So this guy here, modally, it is like a half line. It can be thought of as being very, very, very large. The second theorem is more interesting because it says that if you have only one half plane and then a compact graph here, then again the critical mass of the graph is equal to the critical mass of the half plane, but now you have an interval of energies bounded from below, negative but bounded from below, and this interval of masses is between the critical mass of the half line and the critical mass of the line. So this is a completely new phenomenon. Completely new because there is an interval, a non-trivial interval of masses for which you have a ground state. So this is quite a more interesting phenomenon. And notice that there are some subtleties about the extreme state. Third theorem, again, not very interesting, except that there is hypothesis H coming back. This time, remember, when you have hypothesis H, the graph is made of many lines, in some sense. So it's not surprising that the critical mass of the graph is equal to the critical mass of the line, and the behavior is exactly that of the line. Beyond the critical mass, you have non-lower boundedness, and below the critical mass, you have the limit. The last theorem that we did, so here is the famous signpost again. Basically, there's somewhat a vague formulation. It says there exists a non-compact graph. Okay. We are not able to, we are able to give examples, but not to characterize this class. But there exists some examples of graphs. They have no terminal edges, otherwise they would fall into the scope of theorem one. They have more than a half line, otherwise the theorem 2. Do not satisfy assumption H, otherwise theorem 3. But such that the critical mass of the graph is strictly greater than the critical mass of the half line and strictly lower than the critical mass of the half. And the behavior is still very interesting because beyond the trivial cases minus infinity and zero, again, we have a non-trivial interval of masses for which we have ground state, existence of ground state. This non-trivial interval is between mu g and mu r. Again, there is, here there is no equal, here there is equal, this is somewhat technical. And many examples with a bottleneck here beyond this. So, and this is the end of what I wanted to tell you. I tried to mix some quite pedagogical lines with explicit computation and some more intuitive vision and also and some step into open problem and so on. And I hope, even though most of you, all of you are probably more interested in other aspects of mathematics and mathematical physics, I hope to have given you some occasion of some food for thoughts and some ideas or some technical instrument that will be useful for you in the future. And I thank you very much for your attention. I was really very happy and very honored to be your host to such a nice and interesting audience. Thank you very much.